All right, good afternoon, everyone. Hope everybody's had a good day and got a lot of beneficial rain over the weekend. Dean, I think I heard this morning, your official count, around 1.5 inches?
That was just 24 hours.
Oh, 24 hours?
Over the whole weekend, it was almost 3 inches.
Mine was a little less than you. A little bit over 2 inches.
Cool.
And just a little over 2.
Well, we'll get started, and I apologize, I've got 4:33, we're going to start at 4:30. I was trying to speak with some of our public hearing participants tonight, or this afternoon. We've got, if we do have copies of our agenda up front, if you don't have one, we can have some extra up here. We do have a very, very lengthy work session, and the board will be, after the work session, going up into a called meeting, and during that called meeting, could possibly take care of some of these requests during that time. So let's get started. All right. Today is Monday, April 24th. It's a we're going to a work session as well as a public hearing for the White County Board of Commissioners. First on our agenda. And let me kind of give you the oversight to a lot of you aren't able or have the privilege of participating in these public hearings. On each one of these requests, I'll ask for our staff to give us a overview of what's transpired on the first, the request. Number two, I'll ask the applicant for a brief description. And I do believe we've got representatives from all four of the rezoning or land use applications here. Each, once I open the floor up after that point, as we have a standard procedure, I'll open the floor up for those in support of the applicant, and I'll also open the floor up for those who are perhaps could be opposed to the applications. And if there is a speaker on those matters, I'll give them the standard 3 minutes. But if we happen to have no comments in support or in opposition, I'll give 3 opportunities before we move on to the next item. So for a little bit, it'll be kind of redundant, and you'll understand what I mean by that in just a few minutes. But there are certain criteria that we have to abide by so that we're doing our best to meet the letter of the law. All right. Moving on, item 1, conduct a public hearing for the land use application of Mr. Larry Freeman, 3 district property located at 9669 Duncan Bridge Road, Cleveland, Georgia, from R1 residential district to C2 highway business district. Total acreage affected is 1.44 acres, and that's tax parcel 090-047. Present use is R1, which is residential single family district. Tom, if you'll get us started here and keep it short.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, thank you. This application, Mr. Freeman's application, is a 1.44 acre tract that is to be adjoined to an existing 2.5 acres that he owns along Duncan Bridge Road. There are some properties around here that you have also heard and approved to rezone to C2 highway business. This property in the White County Comprehensive Plan, you know, shows that corridor, that the Duncan Bridge corridor is as low density as its current use, but the future use identifies that corridor, basically State Route 254 up to New Bridge Road, as a commercial / industrial corridor. Because of all the crossroads there, we're seeing a lot of commercial growth, and Mr. Freeman is proposing to rezone, adjoin this property to his and request that it be rezoned to C2.
Any questions for Tom, guys? All right. Thank you. Larry, I'm just calling you Larry. We're going to dispense with formalities. We know each other too well. Larry, give us your address to your existing acreage you've already got that we rezoned here a few months ago, correct?
Yeah, I just, well, I bought the property about a few months ago, and we had it reclassified. And then by the time we got over that, the guy that I bought that property from, he said, just pull a spot behind the barn down here, said, you need it to go with what you got. He didn't want to pay taxes or bush hog it any longer, so I was able to acquire it to go with this. I just need to get it added to the prop, you know, the part that I already have now.
Folks, I'm not going to try to be disrespectful and move on too quick, but Mr. Freeman's request, we've actually dealt with part of this several months ago, or a few months ago. So, guys, any questions for Larry? All right, Larry, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, at this time, I'll open the floor up for public comment. Again, I went over the particulars just a few minutes ago. If you do have a comment in support or an opposition, one, I'll do support first and opposition secondly. If you raise your hand, I'll get to you as quickly as I can. If you do have something you want to say, we need to get your name and address for the official record. So, having said that, I'll open the floor up. Does anyone have any comments in support of Mr. Freeman? As I said a few minutes ago, there's going to be some awkward points. This is the beginning of those awkward points. So, all right, I'll give a second call for any comments in support. As I've said in many meetings in the past, it's not a negative if there's not anyone here to say anything in support or against. That doesn't mean anything at all. So it's just giving everyone ample opportunity. And third call for anyone in support. All right. Now, we'll close those in support. I'll open the floor up for anyone who has, I'm going to use the word opposition, or have any concerns regarding the applications presented by Mr. Freeman. Raise your hand and I'll get to you as quickly as I can. I wish someone up higher up the food chain at the state level would come up with a better way we could conduct these. It wouldn't be quite so awkward, and especially when you have, you know, not any comments, but we have to kind of be consistent on what we do. So I'll ask again a second time. Anyone got any comments they'd like to make? Any concerns regarding the application? It's supposed to rain tonight. If you don't, Dean Dyer's with WRWH. We lean on Dean quite a bit. So if you wonder why we're having this little side, we do this to fill time. So
more ways than one.
Okay. All right. I'll close the floor. Close those in opposition or have concerns. Ms. Shanda, if you'll make note of the record that I did a call for those in support and those in or if you have concerns. And we did not have any, and therefore I'll close that section of the public hearing. Gentlemen, before I move on to the next item, do you guys have any other questions you'd like to? Okay. Oh, before we move on, because of the length of our meeting, I will we'll have one or two breaks late as the meeting progresses. Some of us need it more than others, so that's a joke. If you didn't hear last meeting, you'd understand what I'm talking about. So, and I'm not a stand-up comedian. I don't want to come off as being unprofessional. All right. Ms. Shander or Mr. Mutt, if I miss anything as I'm moving through here, get my attention, please. All right. All right, the public hearing is now finished and concluded on Mr. Freeman's request. I will be, we'll be going to a call meeting in a little bit, and I'll ask the board if the board has any pleasure regarding this request, and we can possibly take care of this request tonight, as well as the other ones that are at office as well. And one of the reasons I shared with the applicants, we have, it looks like to be a possible lengthy meeting next week as well. We're trying to be as efficient as possible so that we don't have, we're not here two Mondays in a row, about 3 or 4 hours each. So our families would like to see us, at least some of us they do. So, all right, item two, conduct a public hearing for the land use application of Ms. Sue Russell to redistrict property located at 1204 and 1206 Ridge Road, Helen, Georgia, 30545, from a C1, which is Community Commercial District, to C2 Highway Business District. Total acres to be affected is 1.34 acres. That's tax parcel 042C-021. The present use is C1 Community Commercial District. Now they're wanting to go to C2. All right, Mr. Tom, you got the hill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The application, Sue Russell, is in front of you today. Representative Ms. Russell is her
sister-in-law,
Rose Ashton. This application is located at 1204 and 1206 Ridge Road, just north of Helen. This is where that business goes on the roof used to be. The family came in, the purchases, they're planning on opening a business with a number of commercial type activities, business, restaurants, store. But one of their activities is actually they want to build a rent Jeep that people could take up in the mountains for the weekend. That particular activity is, which is vehicle rental, is only allowed in a highway business district. So they would like to make that request to go ahead and redistrict the property from C1 to C2 so that they can accommodate that portion of their business activities. C2 also allows them to continue to operate all their C1 proposed parts of their business. There are two building locations where they operate different parts there, different parts of the business on the property. But this rezoning or reclassification would allow them to fully operate everything that they propose to do. It is on a highway off 75. It's a tourism corridor, so there's a lot of heavy traffic. The property adjoins other commercial properties, and the county comprehensive plan identifies this area as second home, seasonal residential, scenic tourism corridor. So it's basically in conformance with the county comprehensive plan. The planning commission did approve this application with the unanimous vote.
All right.
Any questions?
Gentlemen, any questions for Tom? Is unanimous vote by the planning commission. Any comments from the community at all whatsoever?
No,
I didn't see any in the package.
No, sir. They're
well, it's already commercial,
right.
So that's,
yes.
Okay. All right. And Ms. Ashton, I'm not going to put you on the spot too bad. Is there anything you'd like to share with us in addition?
No, I don't want to reiterate anything that Tom said. I just want to point out that under the code, that the granting of the variance will not adversely affect public health, safety, or welfare, or materially injurious to the properties surrounding us.
All right. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. Any other questions, Ms. Ashton? All right. Well, here we go. I officially opened the floor up on the public hearing section, as I did before on Mr. Freeman's request. Open the floor up for those in support, those who have concerns. I'll give three opportunities, minimum 3 minutes, if there's anyone who would like to speak in those matters. So I officially open the floor up. If you raise your hand, I'll get to you as quickly as I can. Those in support that like to make any comments, now will be the time to do so. And while we're waiting here, I failed to recognize that Commissioner Bryan is not going to be able to be with us this evening. He's, it's currently under the weather, so he's going to be absent for this meeting. All right, I'll ask a second time for a, if there's anyone in support. Okay, a third call. Going once, going twice. So, all right, I'll now open the floor if there's anyone who have any comments over the mic or any concerns regarding the application. Are any of you going to be attending the tourism meeting tomorrow?
Today, right?
Eight, correct. Sorry, like I said, we try to fill this little void, so let's see what we can. Second call. Dean, got any jokes?
You doing the tourism meeting tomorrow?
I plan to be there.
And do you know who's actually?
Cindy.
It is Cindy. All right, third call. All right. Ms. Shanda, if you'll make note that we did open the floor, same criteria, three opportunities in support, three opportunities, any concerns. We had no takers. And we'll close that section. And again, as we move on to our call meeting section, after the work session, I'll ask the board's, what the board's pleasure would be at that time. Unless you guys have any other questions you have of the applicant or of staff. All right, moving on to item three, conduct a public hearing for the land use application, Ms. Elaine Reynolds, to redistrict property located at 1679 Helen Highway, Cleveland, Georgia 30528, from a R1, which is residential single family, to C2 Highway Business District. Total acreage is defective, it's 13.00 acres. That's tax parcel 046-008. Present use is R1, residential single family. Mr. Tom, you got the hill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This application from Ms. Reynolds is for this property located on Helen Highway. The total tract is 13 acres. And it adjoins C2 Highway Business property on the north side across the highway from it. And also on the south side is the old lumberyard property that is actually currently some kind of industrial commercial highway. This whole corridor is classified as C2 for some reason, and we can't figure out why, but this piece of property got picked up in our classifications as R1, most likely because there is a small residential tract kind of tucked in the middle of this, where this 13 acres kind of wraps around it, and sometimes the codes talk to each other and keep it that way. Ms. Reynolds' request is to reclassify the property to make it just like all the others within that corridor. The comprehensive plan, future land use, shows this is a community commercial corridor where commercial development can take place in the future. So the code request is consistent with that. This application was reviewed by the Planning Commission and was approved unanimously. Okay.
And Tom, just to reiterate for the record, no one from the community or no one came out with any concerns, etc.
Yes, sir.
Okay, correct. All right. Well, we'll get on if there's any questions. Guys, any questions for Tom? Okay. All right, Tom, thank you. Ms. Elaine? She's here, Ms. Lane's here to answer any questions you guys would have. Your request is just to essentially let it what it should have been to begin with.
Yes, I'm just trying to align with all the other properties on the Helen Highway, yes.
Any plans currently, by the package there were none?
No, no current plans.
Okay, just going ahead and planning ahead.
That's right.
I understand. All right. Okay, any questions, Ms. Lane? Thank you. All right, we'll move on to the, open up the floor of the hearing section. Same criteria, open up those in support, as well as we'll lead into those with any concerns. And we'll give everyone the same opportunities, I won't beat that to the ground again. So if you would like to make any comments in support, please raise your hand, now will be the time. Give a second opportunity, those in support. And we'll do one more call for anyone who'd like to do anything in support. All right. At this time, I'll open the floor for those who've made any comments or have any concerns regarding the application. Now would be the time. National Day of Prayers next Thursday. Is that right? Next Thursday, Wednesday. Shannon, you might want to check with the board, see if there's going to be a quorum present. I'm just thinking aloud. I'm looking at ways to fill this time, so.
May 4th.
May 4th. Okay. Second call for those with any concerns regarding the application. I told you this is awkward. Boring, awkward.
Looks like somebody come in mad or something.
All right. Okay, third call for those with any concerns. All right, having none, all right, we'll close the public hearing section. And same thing, we'll bring the subject up here just a little bit. We go into a work session, I mean, our call meeting, excuse me. All right. Oh, did y'all have any more questions? I'm sorry. I'm on a roll here.
No, sir.
All right. Item four, conduct a public hearing for the land use application of Kelly and Gary Mills to redistrict property located at 457 Highway 255 South, Cleveland, Georgia 30528, from R1, which is residential single family, to A1, which is agricultural forestry district. Total acres to be affected is 5.0 acres. That's tax parcel 061-089. Again, the present use is R1 residential family district. Mr. Tom, you got the deal.
Mr. Chairman, this application is from Kelly and Gary Mills. They have two tracts of land. One is a 5-acre tract, and there's an adjacent 11-acre tract that they own. The front 5 acres was picked up because it has a house on it and was classified as R1. The 11 acres that is attached to or adjacent to it that they own is actually classified as A1, and it's actually has a conservation, agricultural conservation easement on it. They would like to make the classification consistent, so they're requesting that they take this 5 acres and put it into A1. Agriculture allows for residential units to be on it. It would put the whole 16 acres into A1, and not the properties wouldn't have two different land use classifications. The comp plan, future land use map shows us this area is low density residential and agricultural throughout that whole valley. That's on the east side of Yonah Mountain. And so it is consistent with the future land use for that area. The planning commission reviewed this application and approved it unanimously. And just to follow up, Mr. Chairman, we did not have anybody there in the hearing to draw decisions.
All right.
The minutes that you have.
Correct.
Like that.
Any questions for Tom? All right. Thanks, Tom. I know we have with us both Kelly and Gary Mills. They're here with us, and I won't put you on the spot. If you guys have any questions for them, essentially the gist of it is you want to take what you've got already and put it with your larger tract, make it all agriculture.
Right.
Simple version.
Right.
What is the one that they're adding to? Make it agriculture.
Their tract is.
This is a, what you're talking about, this one. And this is a.
Okay, not here. Yeah, we're right here. And then this is all around, this is all.
Oh, okay. Well, you had the wrong one marked.
Yeah.
And it didn't make sense what you're talking about, where the map looked.
Yeah, we just.
Okay.
Looking at the shape of that.
And you should.
Okay.
Yeah, somewhere it changed, you didn't catch it till you got it.
Okay. It just didn't, what you're talking about, and the one that far didn't make sense.
Okay.
Cool.
All right. Okay. You have any questions for the Mills? Same, here we go. Open up the floor for those in support, and I'll open the floor for those who have any concerns. First call for those in support. Yeah, it didn't line up, it was all yellow. So, I was under the assumption that if we got this for somebody, we could call it. We would destroy some of the time.
But it was this one down here, down there, not there.
Yeah. Tom, if you'll make sure Harry Marsh is there next time.
And he's our neighbor, that's pretty bad.
Yeah.
I wouldn't admit that, but.
You want this to get approved, don't you?
I wouldn't admit that, but I'd be willing to have a discussion about it.
All right, second call, I've lost my call here. Second call for those in support. Okay, third call. All right, we'll close that. If you, raise your hand if you have any, if you want to speak regarding any concerns regarding the application. How's it done? We start making some of our state senator and our state representatives come sit in on some of these. And realize how odd and weird it is. Second call for those who have concerns or perhaps in opposition. Okay, third call. Ms. Shanda, if you'll notate the record that I opened the floor three separate times for those in support and for those who have any concerns regarding the application and having none, I'll close the close the public hearing. Gentlemen, any other questions you guys may have for the applicant in this situation? All right, same thing, I'm going to ask, we're going to go to a call meeting a little while and possibly take care of this tonight. Okay. Moving on to item five, Mr. Kevin Hambier, SPLOST manager of special purpose local option sales tax, to present our monthly SPLOST status update. Mr. Kevin, you got the hill. And gentlemen, at your places, you should have a copy, you guys, they got a copy of it. Okay.
Everything's going according to plan. That's a good thing. We haven't got the April check yet. So the numbers you see in the report there reflect the actual check through March this year. So again, just to recap really quick, the revised estimated revenue is a good bit over than our original referendum revenue, which is a good thing. We're about 38.8% through the program. This is a recap of where we are to date. Those are the account balances, as you see, that 1,978 again does not include the April check. That is a projection at this point. City encumbrances, these are all the commitments the board has made for this particular fund, and we're on the good side. As long as we can keep getting about $300,000 a month, we'll be on the good side at $1.1 million by the end of the year. Good report.
Now, let me make a note, as Mr. Hambier and I were talking, the key on the very bottom is available by year end. That's monies that we accumulate throughout the year. That's an accumulated total. We don't have that sitting available for, I mean, to spend right now. No problem. Correct?
Correct.
All right.
That's the projection. If you keep getting $300,000 a month in SPLOST revenue, that being the minimum, so those numbers will hold true.
Right.
Yeah. And that's going to be that much would be how much we have that's not obligated.
Correct.
Right. Then if you look above, you can see the obligations that have been made today by December.
I see you still have $923,000 against the Carolina Spring Road.
That's all the roads.
That's all of our paving projects. That's all our paving projects.
Oh.
Spring Road paving, not Carolina.
Okay.
We spent a little money in this past month. We spent a little money on Spring Road paving. And we've added the sheriff's office vehicle there, but the net effect really didn't change the bottom line that much.
We should get our April check any day now.
That's correct. Right. They normally send it the very last week of the month. And proposals will be in on Thursday for the park, just kind of off the spot subject. We'll be getting proposals for the construction manager at risk on Thursday. Jamie will be receiving those at 4 o'clock, so we'll be moving forward.
At the pre-bid meeting, do we have one?
We did not.
We did not. Okay. But have you received interest from potential bidders?
I think we're going to have some. There's some good proposals.
Okay.
I think so.
All right. Okay. All right. Got any other questions? Okay. All right. Kevin, thank you for your time. I know you got to hit the road and get on the road and head to Athens. Thank you very much. All right. Moving on to item six, discuss assignment of services agreement with Sentinel Offender Services LLC and CSRA Probation Services Incorporated related to the probation services of White County Probate Court and White County Magistrate Court. Judge Baker, I'm not putting on the spot, but I'm going to ask you to take the lead on this to explain to us all what all we're doing and what the request is. I think I understand it, but.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, basically what has happened is Sentinel Offender Services, our private probation provider, has a current contract with the courts for both the magistrate court and the probate court. have seized operations in Georgia. They're pulling out of Georgia completely, and so those existing contracts that they've had have been sold. And our contract, all of the contracts actually were picked up by CSRA, which is a middle Georgia probation provider, and it actually will make CSRA the largest service provider in the state. They've got about 110 courts now. And this is, since our contract doesn't end until next year, anyway, we would have to be renewed. This is simply a transfer of the current contract out of Sentinel's hands into CSRA. We have looked at the company. The company's been in business for a number of years. They do a good job, and we're excited about having that. It's my understanding that CSRA, which actually stands for Coastal Savannah Regional Area, they're going to change that, and I'm not sure what the new name, they haven't decided on that yet, but they will be taking more generic Georgia Probation Services type name, which will identify, but they will provide the contract services as set out in the original. So it's just basically changing the name, changing the service provider. But I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Any complaints or anything recorded for this company?
Now, we have not received any complaints as far as that. You know, everyone, I think, may be aware of the situation we had under Sentinel, because Sentinel actually had a federal lawsuit that had been filed against them for practices that they had in providing their services. Of course, those services that they were providing were outside the scope of the courts or even the county, so neither the probate court nor the county itself was involved in that. Federal lawsuit. That suit was settled earlier this year, in fact in January, and it was at that time that I think that Sentinel made the decision that they were going to leave Georgia, so that's what they've done, and this is the change of.
All right, Judge, not so much direct you, but staff, given the assignment of a contract that hasn't come before the board since I've been sitting as chairman, with the full contract comes up for renewal a year from now, at that time, are there other competitive bidders out there? I'm just looking ahead.
What we do as a court general is we look at the size of the company that comes in, and then we either have the option to open up if we're not satisfied with the services that we receive, and we can open up, or the contract does renew on an annual basis without having to bid.
Okay. One error in the contract I found, it says address for notices. It has listed a 675 True Love Road, Cleveland, Georgia, and I think that's the road department. So for some reason, they've got a mailing address at True Love Road. That will ever see it if they send it to True Love Road. No offense. But if y'all could make sure note that gets changed. 1235 Pellet Highway, please. Any questions from the judge? And Judge, thank you for making.
We're having a party outside, but it's only invitation only.
Invitation only. We didn't get to anybody. We wonder why the sheriff's sitting out in the hallway.
He has a gun.
Well, and we're aware of the the issues regarding the current provider. So you feel confident this will take care of the issues?
I do, and as we said, you know, from the practices and being that the suit action went forward on did not involve, you know, our court, but I was essentially going beyond what the courts had ordered. And so I'm confident that we took a look at this company that is taking over the contract. They've got a good track record, they've got a good collection process, which we were impressed with, and they've actually got a better mechanism for payments that can be made in probation. So we're excited actually about seeing some changes take place that make probation services a little bit simpler and easier for both the courts and for those that are placed on probation.
All right, thank you. Ms. Shandy, anything wrong with this place that's on consent, or do we need to officially vote on this? Gentlemen, that's been a recommendation. Judge Baker, consent?
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Judge, thank you for your time. Feel free to hang around. Just leave us a stake. I'm not meeting.
We finish stake, and I'm gonna clean up and go home.
Yeah. All right. Sorry, we've gotta make light here, folks. Moving on to item seven, discuss the grant acceptance of the 2016 JAG Burn Act in the amount of $86,709 from the Franklin County Board of Commissioners related to the absorption of the North Georgia District Task Force by the Appalachian Regional Drug Enforcement Office. Mr. Howard, how are you, man?
Good, how are you?
Live away, clerk enthusiastic.
Y'all ready for me?
We're ready for you. You're and sorry. Introduce yourself for the crowd. They might not know you.
Ken Howard. I'm Assistant Special Agent in Charge with the GBI, Appalachian Regional Drug Enforcement Office. So that just is a fancy way of saying I'm the number two guy over there at the Regional Drug Enforcement Office. I'm here on Mitchell Posey's behalf, who is the Drug Task Force Supervisor. He's out of town training this week. And for your consideration, today is the acceptance of that grant and the absorption of what was previously known as the North Georgia Regional Drug Enforcement Office. They covered a piece of northeast Georgia. The task force boundaries changed over time and over the years to its most recent coverage area being the Franklin County Sheriff's Office and the Livonia Police Department. And they weren't able to satisfy, for various reasons, the CJCC requirements of running a multi-agency regional drug task force. And we thought, after careful consideration and discussions, that it made more sense to absorb the remaining personnel at that task force into the Appalachian Regional Drug Enforcement Office. And what that would mean is taking on two additional task force agents, one from the Franklin County Sheriff's Office and one from the Livonia Police Department. We also gain, as a benefit to the Regional Drug Enforcement Office here, an additional GBI agent who is an Assistant Special Agent in Charge, is the title he holds, like myself. So it gives us another supervisor in the office to help us manage the personnel that we have at the office and to manage the day-to-day operations. And we would also absorb, of course, their 80,000 plus, I believe is what they have remaining in their grant to help offset the cost of those two additional personnel. Of course, the GBI pays the salary and the equipment costs and all of those things for the GBI agents that are taking on.
Don't mind me asking, you know, the last couple of years, I say we, I feel like we've all got a sense of ownership in this. You know, we've taken on additional counties. Do you, how much further outreach do you see this going? Do you feel like we're getting close as far as the kind of the scope of how far we're reached out? Now what we're saying is our expansion. Do we expand? Are we looking to expand anymore?
Well, I can tell you there's not an easy, short answer. But to start off with where you did, we, of course, as the Appalachian Regional Drug Enforcement exists today, the model that we are operating wouldn't be possible without the support of this commission and the community. We've had a tremendous amount of support, both from the commission, which we appreciate, the sheriff's office here, and a very large amount of support from the local community. And we don't get that all around the city. My agents, myself, we appreciate that involvement from the community. As far as the expansion goes, we were running up against some span of control issues before this expansion. What we saw, though, in the benefit of expanding and just encompassing one municipality and one county is we get that additional GBI ASAC, which is going to help relieve some of Mitchell's burden and mine and give us a little more freedom to mentor these agents in the field, these deputies in the field, and improve on the overall mission of the task force. So I think that's a good thing. We do have interest from time to time. At any given time, I've gotten interest from, as has Mitchell, from other sheriff's offices and municipalities around the state, and that changes from month to month. And we're just very cautious in
in making those decisions because of the span of control issues. We want to make sure that we can still provide, it's a balance in that, can we continue to provide the service that we are, that the constituents in our span of control have become accustomed to, and we're going to be able to maintain that if we take on these additional resources. So I know that's a long-winded answer for what you asked.
I just didn't know if it was on the horizon.
No, there's nothing that I've seen on the horizon, but there's always interest. But with that said, you guys know that we wouldn't go down that road without careful consideration and a lot of discussion with you guys. The task force where it's at today, it's in a great place. I never thought I'd see a task force, frankly. I've worked 20 years in drug enforcement with GBI, and this is the strongest task force that I've seen and been a part of as far as personnel, the capabilities of the task force, and the services they provide to the community. So I'm very pleased with where the task force is right now.
How many counties does it attract?
Well, that's another interesting question. On paper, according to the CJCC, we're responsible for 25 counties, I believe was the number, give or take. Now, what that means is because of the way the grant's structured, we will provide services to those 17 or 18 counties who aren't participating members on the control board, who don't contribute agents. We will provide services. Primarily, what it was set up for was in the event they have methamphetamine labs that they need dismantled and disposed of, because we have a specialized training to do it. And CJCC made that part of the requirement that came along with the grant was, since there's nobody covering, they don't have any multi-jurisdictional task forces covering those counties, and they don't have a specialized training, they said, you guys are going to have to provide that service.
So you're providing a service to some counties that you don't get anything from them?
Yeah, nothing in the form of an agent working at our office, no contributions financially, monetarily, other than what we get in the form of that grant from the federal government. Now, a lot of these agencies and counties, municipalities, we have good working relationships with, so they share intelligence with us that's useful to us, we share with them, but nothing, you know, financially or personnel-wise. And thank goodness, we don't respond that often. I can count probably on one hand how many meth labs we've actually had to respond to and dismantle and dispose of. They're just not as prevalent as they were 5, 10, 15 years ago for various reasons. So it's not been very taxing on us to do that.
You know, I forget how many folks you got based out of this one office.
Oh, man, I believe we have 14 badge wearers now, certainly counting the GBI folks assigned to the office. And of course, one of our task force agents, who was a representative from Cleveland Police Department, Thad Joe, he was recently hired by the GBI as a special agent. And we were able to lobby the administration and headquarters to allow him, once he finishes his GBI training, to come back and work at our office, which is a great asset because he's already got two years on the ground working as a task force agent. He can come back in, we don't have to train him, and as a GBI agent, he can help in the field, not just working cases, obviously, but as a mentor and a trainer to some of the task force agents. And the only other changes I see on the horizon, if any, is we're always logging and we're getting some traction with headquarters to get an additional GBI agent assigned to the office, which will just be a good bonus.
Well, thank you for the update. Gentlemen, any other questions? I think it's pretty straightforward. Consent? Consent agenda? Hey, Donald, thank you.
Thank y'all.
We'll take care of this at our consent agenda at the next meeting.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Moving on to item 8, discuss renewal of memorandum with the Enotah Judicial Circuits counties, conduct activities for the Enotah Judicial Circuits Juvenile Justice Project coordinated through Family Connections. As a mouthful, who's got the hill on that one?
I'll take it, Mr. Chairman. This was a memorandum of agreement that you entered into back in 2013. It's just a continuation of that agreement. We don't really do anything. We just signed on with the Enotah Circuit. Union County has most of the responsibility for the juvenile justice part of it. They administer, they're the fiscal agent, they administer it, they do all that sort of thing. We're just, because we're a member of the Enotah Circuit, they've asked that we just make that commitment to continue the memorandum of agreement.
Do you feel comfortable that everything's going well, continue forward with it?
Yes, sir.
I thought you consented.
I recommend it for you.
Consent?
Thank you.
All right, moving on to item nine, discuss bids received for matured CD, certificate deposit, which is currently held at United Community Bank, in the amount of $169,400. It's fairly simple. Rates are horrible. We received two bids. Yeah. We received two bids, of course, one from United Community Bank and the other from Mountain Valley Community Bank, with Mountain Valley Community Bank bidding at a whopping 0.421% or APY, that's an annual percentage yield. So, folks in the audience, that's less than 0.5% for 12 months. But these are monies, the county does reserve the right to pull these monies. We have no prepayment, no penalty for early withdrawal.
Liam might comment that it's a 400% increase from last year.
We're in the money. It's just when you start with zero.
Zero, 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 one.
Yeah. That's horrible. So my recommendation would be a place of consent, go with Mountain Valley at the 0.421 APY. You all agree with that?
Yes.
All right. Item 10. Discuss bids received for local maintenance improvement grant, bridge rehabilitation project related to one bridge located on Towns Creek Road and the other two bridges on New Bridge Road. Mr. Melton, or Dave, who's got the hill on that one?
Dave's got the hill on it.
All right, Dave, you got the hill.
Thank you, Chairman.
All right.
We were able to receive bids this morning at 10:30. We had three contractors, and we had a low bid. Our lowest bid was $1,800,078.87. Okay, now that could turn into $2,047,434 if we have a problem with the bridge after we mill it down. So staff is requesting that we get a chance to talk with the engineer and Mr. Melton to just see how we can figure this out.
Our cost estimate, gentlemen, was just a little over $500,000. $536,000 was the cost estimate. We need to sit, we just got the bids this morning. We need time to sit down with the engineer and figure out why the bids were over three times.
We have no idea why the cost were so high.
We actually had two different cost estimates. One from the current engineer that we're using. We also had an old cost estimate from KCI, and they were pretty much in line. Mm-hmm. And the only thing I can come up with at this point is just too much work out there for these contractors. We have got to have some time to sit down and analyze the bids, and we will try to come back next week. Keep this as a placeholder on the agenda and try to come back next week and give the board some evaluation of what happened with these bids.
Just put on regular vote. If we need to, at that time, make the motion to table again, we'll do that. But we'll put on the regular vote, Ms. Shanda. Just makes you downright mad.
Well, and also, you know, But it shows that there's a lot of work going on.
Well, I think you're, you know, we have.
Picking over work.
Yeah, you know, a couple items down is the Carolina Springs Road. I think we're gonna be, I'm afraid we're gonna be disappointed on that. We'll have to wait and see. I think there's just a lot of work out there at this time.
Yeah, Mr. Freeman, I'm not gonna put you on the spot. You're in the, kind of, you see that side, the commercial side of things. People have gotten pretty busy in the commercial side of the corner, haven't they? And what we're running to, it seems like folks are, they're hunting and picking, and they're gonna make it worth their time if they're gonna bid on these projects. And they think that, you know, we as the county or quote-unquote government, we're just rolling in cash and we'll pay whatever. That's what it seems like comes up on this side of the desk. And we're trying to be diligent with the funds that have been entrusted to us and not get taken to the cleaners. So, sorry, that's free.
Well, DOT's got a lot of work, and when they're paying $3.5 million bonuses to contractors, it's more rich.
Yeah, bridge fell down, yeah. Sorry, that's, this will be about there.
You heard anything new on the airport road bridge?
No, it's currently in the, the DOT has a program into their program, bridge program. They haven't given us a date on it. But it is in your program, and they are supposed to be posted.
All right, we'll leave on the agenda for regular vote next Monday then. All right. Item 11, discuss upgrade of road department's chipper. That's tab 11 in your book.
Hey, thank you.
Long time no see.
Okay. Back in 97, we received a chipper through the Brimwood to the chipper program. A nice chipper, 12 inch. And we were able to, after a snowstorm we had in 2015, we got some FEMA money for some equipment, and we were able to purchase a 12 inch chipper with that money, and also some chainsaws and some safety equipment. Just recently, probably in the past year, we had some problems with that chipper. There was a short with it, and we couldn't figure out where it was coming from. So we brought back the Mason tractor, and they couldn't figure it out either. So I asked them for a loaner, and they gave us a nice loaner, a 15 inch eye-opening loaner, which we actually could do twice the work at half the time, and like the guy just said that they loved it. So I took one step further, and in front of you you have some numbers. The 15 inch chipper is selling for $49,944.40. And they'll give us $38,000 for our chipper with a difference of $11,944. Now keep in mind that our chipper, we're able to get $32,150 for it with the $5,000 trading for that 97. So we're actually getting the same price, $38,000. Okay, we have towards this chipper. So staff is just requesting that we can get this chipper. We have money in our budget, current budget, that we would just tighten up for the next month and a half. That would be about $11,944 if we could get this chipper. This chipper would definitely be amazing for us. So that's what I'm requesting. Like I said, we'll just tighten up for the next month and a half.
Dave, you feel,
one of our budgets, sir.
You feel confident you can afford this? I mean, straight up, out of your current.
Yes, sir. I've been through this, Roland and I. I mean, yes, sir.
The 12 inch, you said that was purchased in 2015?
Yes, sir.
So there wasn't any kind of warranty or anything on it, or couldn't be fixed, or what are they telling us?
It was like 1 year warranty on it. I mean, it was just like, the warranty, it was like, school of 15, 16.
I would just think that, that kind of money for that kind of equipment, that sure is a short time.
Yeah.
Not bad.
We don't want to have to.
Get something done.
Do this every 12 months, we don't want to try to chip it every 12 months.
The good thing about this new chipper is, it'll have like 20,000 hours, 20 hours, 200 hours on it. And they're gonna give us a warranty like a brand new chipper.
So it's hours, how many hours? Hours or more?
Just strictly 1 year on the warranty?
Yeah, it's a 2016, it's pretty much a leftover, almost 2017.
Yeah, okay.
So it was definitely open our eyes up, and when somebody gave me the warranty, I'm like.
They normally repair them, they're nice of them, don't they normally do the repairs on?
Yeah, and they really want our business, and they're really trying to be good with us, and that's why they're doing this. And we really like the chipper, and they feel confident that this chipper will be nice too for us.
Mr. Mountain, the dollar amount of this, should we bid the whole project out? I don't want to prolong it.
They're gonna give us our money back, basically all our money back on the chipper that we bought. They're gonna give us $38,000, that's what we paid, that's what.
And they know it's a piece of junk.
That was the original.
No.
Price of the chipper, well, I don't know if it's a piece of junk, I don't think it's.
It had a short in it, and here it is 18 months later, it's a piece of junk.
I don't think it's really a big enough chipper for our needs.
Yeah.
I think we really should have bought, at the time, we just didn't realize that we should have bought a bigger chipper. And they're gonna give us our money back for the chipper, so I would just look at it as a trade-in.
Trade-in and upgrade?
And an upgrade.
Yes, sir.
And an additional $11,000 will give us a bigger chipper.
Mr. Shannon, that's right.
No, I don't mind, I'm just kidding.
Uh-huh or uh-uh?
It don't mind. Don't ask me for.
Consent. Consent, Mr. Shannon.
Sure.
All right, thanks, man.
Okay. I do have one more announcement.
Aren't you out?
I'm trying to say it.
This is Jason.
It's just money, what are you talking about?
Is this the name?
Just about, I want to make an announcement that we're repairing the bridge in Charlie Thomas on May 9th and possibly 10th, so we'll be closing Charlie Thomas for a couple days for those repairs, okay?
May 9th or 10th, 10th or 10th?
May 9th and 10th, please agree with me with the weather.
We've got to replace the timbers on it.
Yeah.
Timbers are rotted out.
All right, we'll let all the news agencies know and.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we've got a press release.
School board.
We're putting some signs, because they come through there like Haley's kid.
Yeah. All right, Dave, thanks, man.
I think I'm done.
All right, appreciate it. Move on, we're spending more money. Right, item 12, discuss upcoming bid opening for Caroline Springs Road, April 28th, correct?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
All right, so that item will be back before us to discuss next week?
Yes, sir. Hopefully with this time around, this is.
Okay. Okay, I'll move on. All right, item 13, discuss proposals for the Yonah Preserve Project Construction Manager Risk Proposals. That's what I've been, okay, those proposals are due April 27th. We just discussed that with Mr. Hamby a few minutes ago.
That's correct.
That's this Thursday, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so we'll have that on the regular vote for a week from today, correct?
That's correct.
All right. As soon as y'all get those, if you could, email us that and the one before that. That data, so we'll have at least a weekend to maybe digest it.
We'll send it out as soon as we get it. That's all of it.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Item 14, Mr. David Murphy, Director of Public Safety, present a very short public safety annual report.
I shortened it from an hour to 30 minutes, so you guys should.
Motion to adjourn.
Thanks, sir.
Gentlemen, Mr. Chairman, the board, this is your annual report for public safety. I'm just going to hit some highlights out of your report. The document I've submitted to you is got some pretty extensive stats for each division. We published this report a couple of weeks ago and had it ready for you for tonight. And for public consumption, this will be posted on our website. And also have been distributed to local media, and we do have copies available in the office for the public if they wish to have a hard copy. First of all, let's start with animal services. Last year, animal services responded to 1,394 incidents, mostly stray animals. City of Cleveland had 293 incidents, and City of Helena had a total of 31. Our revenues increased by about 30% for the fiscal year. This was based on an increase in adoption. Some significant accomplishments for the department. They received over 5,000 grant opportunities for adoption assistance and spay and neuter programs. Our euthanasia rate continues to decline. Most of the euthanasias are for feral cats. The new quarterly special adoption program that you gentlemen approved for us to do has been a very good success in the first year. And also we started our training program with our officers, and we currently have two officers that are certified in basic training. This is something that they had never had before. We started that program and developed a program for them, and they continue to find additional training. Next, please. Under emergency management, wildfire continues to be our biggest natural threat, as you saw in the past year through the Gatlinburg and some of the calls of fires in North Carolina and North Georgia. That is our biggest natural threat that we try to prepare for each and every day. Our agency continues to be involved in preparedness to fight that type of natural disaster, plus others that we come in contact with. Emergency management responded to over 163 incidents, and we activated emergency operations center twice in 2016. Sponsored over 15 training events for staff and other departments. Accomplished over 300 hours of training. And last year we received $47,616 in grant funds for three projects, the ATV and then the outdoor warning and siren that's located at the Saltee Fire Station. Next, please. 911 communications, telephone operations call volume was at 114,105 calls for 2016. Total incidents and radio operations was 191,141 incidents. If you look at those numbers, the telephone, that's any incoming and outgoing phone call that operators had to handle during the year. And the total incidents, that is the operators actually communicating radio traffic to the agencies that we serve. Law enforcement is our biggest user, with the sheriff's office accounting for 56% of all law enforcement activity. Busiest day of the week for 2016 was a Friday, and busiest hour of the day was 1 p.m. We also noted that our still, as years pass, our highest call volumes come between Monday through Friday, between about 8 a.m. and 9 p.m. Under fire services, we continue to maintain our newest ISO rating of a 4, 4Y. There are some areas that are still 10s in the county. We have 12 career firefighters, 2 part-time, and 46 volunteers. Station 5 at Shoal Creek had the most volunteer firefighters. We added a net of 2 volunteers in 2016. They responded to 1,402 incidents. Station 2 on Duncan Bridge was the busiest station, with Station 4 on Westmoreland being the second, and then Station 6 at Chesney being the third busiest station. The truck with the most responses in 2016 was Rescue 2. At 370 incidents, Rescue 2 is located on Duncan Bridge Road. Total apparatus responses was 3,221 times the trucks rolled out of the station. 77% of all incidents
were medical, while structured fires and illegal burns tied at 27% respectively. Average response time is 10 minutes with firefighters' time at instance totaling 4,482 hours. This is the number of hours total that they spend on actual events last year. And then personnel, volunteers and paid completed 3,748 hours of training for 2016. And with that, that's a short version of the extensive report. I'd be glad to take any questions.
Dave, you said this report's going to be posted on the website?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Well, thank you for your department, all the departments you oversee. If we start, we continue to see the growth of our community, we're also seeing a greater demand on services from, you know, emergency management, law enforcement, the sheriff's here, he's attached to all that, fire department. It's, as we grow, you're going to experience growing pains, and we are doing that. So, David, thank you for your time. Any other comments at this time, gentlemen?
Oh, just thank you, David. You do a good job. We appreciate it.
All right. David, hang tight. You and Dave are hanging out too much. You're back to back to back.
We did hang out today.
All right. Item 15, discuss grant acceptance for White County Emergency Management Agency, EMA, related to affordable generator grant, amount of $59,580 even. County budgeted match already of $8,937 even from federal and Georgia Emergency Management Agencies, FEMA and GMA.
Gentlemen, this is a grant that we applied for under the Hazard Mitigation Program 4215, which is from the winter storms of 2016. We applied for a grant through FEMA for a generator. This will be a 56 to 60 kW generator. Will be on trailer mounted diesel tank, similar to the last one we received. Our share, the total grant was $59,580. The county's local share will be $8,937, or 15%. And we would ask you to consider approval for Mr. Melton to sign the grant documents and for the finance department to make the appropriate line out of budget adjustment. The $8,937 share is budgeted in the grant fund for this fiscal year.
Consent, gentlemen?
Yeah.
Consent, there. Mm-hmm. Consent, Ms. Shannon. Item 16. And for those in the audience who don't know what's a consent, these are items we'll take to our next regular meeting, and we're able to potentially approve all these items in one full motion, multiple items at one time. So, David, go to item 16. Discuss grant acceptance for White County Emergency Management, EMA, related to a grant for a weather station located at White County High School, amount $38,823 even, with county budgeted match of $5,824 from FEMA for GMA.
Again, this is under the 4215 Hazard Mitigation Grant Program, a total grant of $38,823 with a county share of $5,824. This amount is also budgeted in the grant fund for this fiscal year. This project is a weather station, and I think Ms. Shannon's got a link she can pull up and should give you an example of what this will look like. This provides a web-based link. It also provides a app for citizens that they can sign up and get their local weather information. Also for the this will be located at White County High School. We'll be using some of their infrastructure out there to place this system on. This is the web-based version that you see that's at Riverside Military Academy in Gainesville. This is a network of systems that are provided all across the nation. One thing we're also adding to ours is a lightning detection units. These lightning detection units will be primarily at the high school. They are required to have them with GHSA rules for their football program and outdoor activity programs, where it will actually send an alert to the device at the high school. It will flash, it will alarm and say lightning is within so many miles according to the GHSA rules, and they have to suspend activity, outdoor activity, for 30 minutes until that last lightning strike is done. Currently, they're just using some little antiquated hand equipment to do that. This would be a more effective system. We're also going to put alarms at our park and recs, county park and rec facility on Asbestos Road, and also one at the soccer complex. So they would get those same lightning detection alerts at those facilities as well. The school system is also going to use some of the data coming off of this for the two programs. One, their science programs, teaching meteorology in the high school, and also the Warrior TV, teaching kids how to do meteorology and do weather. So it's a pretty comprehensive system. This will be a sole source weather bug project, so as soon as we get all the grant documents ready to go, we'll be able to institute this. Again, it provides a website. I think Dean, I know, uses the one that we currently have that we've had since 2002 or 3 on our website. And this is a more advanced system, and we actually have a camera up on the pole at the high school that you can turn and look all around and see the weather activity. I think there's some actually on this website as examples around the state. But that's what we want to do. That's what this particular grant will be paying for.
So we can tell that how we're feeling?
Yeah, look up at the emoji.
Yeah.
Very scientific.
I feel good.
That's the new, that's how we communicate with our younger generation.
How do they communicate to us?
That's a good question.
David, yeah, just going to ask a question. I know we're all thinking it. Is the school system participating financially or any in kind in any way in the project?
They are participating in kind. We're being allowed to use their facilities to construct this equipment on the poles and so forth, and they're going to pay for that. Any additional installation charges involved there. We're also in negotiation and talk with them about the ongoing maintenance costs of having to support that.
There's a recurring fee?
There's a recurring fee. It's about $4,700 a year. And again, right now, we're looking at them to pay that.
Okay.
All right. You've got this budgeted and it stands in your current budget?
Yes, sir, it is.
Saves lives. What do you say?
Our match of that comes out of your budget?
It comes out of the grant fund. Our match does, yes, sir. 58-24. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. All right, we'll finish up items 17, 18, and 19, and we'll take a brief break. Item 17, discuss options for 2017-18 employee benefits renewal. In your packet, we have our insurance benefits review. Ms. Shander, are you taking the lead on that?
During your budget retreat, our insurance broker, Matt Bidwell with MSI Benefits, provided this benefit review to you where we stand. He did present an option that the board, there was a consensus that the board was favorable with, which would equal a 12.46% increase to the county, which equals to $193,098. And that, I don't know how this next slide will show up on there, but you have it in your packets as well. Basically, the option that the board seemed favorable with was to create a base plan, which would increase the deductible $500 from where we are now, and we lower the co-insurance from 80% to 70% and increase the out-of-pocket maximum from $5,000 to $6,350. Would also increase the copays at office visits from $25 to $30, and specialty copays from $50 to $60. That would then become our base plan, and employees could choose to buy up to the current plan, and they would be responsible to pay the difference. That was, seemed like a happy medium that the board wanted to consider in a voting meeting, so that we can move forward with our open enrollment towards the beginning of May, since our claims dictated that if we stayed where we were, we were going to be at an increase of $322,440. So when we looked for options, that base and buy-up option is what seemed to be the best way to go forward. And I'll be happy to answer any questions. We also talked.
Go back to that.
We also talked about the current non-wellness rate for those employees who don't meet the annual wellness requirement, either getting an age-appropriate physical or participating in our wellness fair. Right now, employees are charged an additional $25 a pay period if they don't meet that requirement. The board did express some interest in increasing that amount. We've been in that wellness rate structure now for going on 4 years, and we still have several employees who don't participate in that. And the law does allow us to charge those folks more if they don't meet that requirement.
One question from May. Do we have anybody that has come to you or Chris Lee, the one, and expressed why they don't, do they have a legitimate reason not to participate? I mean, we don't want to make it hard on somebody, and we're talking about 18 people out of 200, so.
Well, the options that are given are to either go to your doctor, and they sign off that you've had an age-appropriate physical. If you fit in the age band that only requires you to have a physical every, 3 years, they just sign the paper and send it back to us. If they do require a physical, there is no copay for physicals. So it's just, it's no money out of their pocket. Right. It's a matter of scheduling that appointment, which I'm sure it's not convenient for me, but it's just something I do, something all of us do mostly.
The health fair is a lot easier than that.
And the health fair, we've done all that we can to make that as easy for folks to attend. We start at dark 30 in the morning before everybody goes to work, and we go up until, a little after 10 and have folks there the whole time. Some folks just don't want to go to the doctor. They don't like the idea of having blood drawn, or maybe it's inconvenient, or maybe the $25 that we charge just doesn't outweigh any inconvenience they have in scheduling that. But certainly we see that annual screening and follow-up with your doctor as a very effective way to catch a health issue before it results in, a large claim. And we want to promote that.
Well, we've got about four department heads, three department heads and constitutional officer here. Have y'all had any complaints from Sheriff? You had any complaints from me? I know you got one that hit the floor like a rock up and everybody's, all his buddies are trying to get a picture of him so they can hold it over his head. But it didn't seem to bother him. He seemed to be enjoying it. But have you had any complaints from any of your people?
Not that I'm aware of.
David, you got a pretty good crowd, and Dave, you've got the other big crowd.
Well, in today's world environment we live in, health screenings are part of life. I think we all feel that way, and it could actually benefit the individual in finding something in early detection. And I think you go to the private sector, you may not even be given a choice. It's either you do or you don't. So, this is the item we're actually going to vote on in our next, and we're going to call a meeting in a few minutes. And I've got some comments I'll actually make it at that time. So, any more comments? There you have anything. Flint?
That's good.
Item 18, discuss upcoming board appointments. Tab 18 in your book. I guess Shanda, you need advice or direction to go ahead and start advertising?
I'm just basically notifying the board in a public meeting of these. I've sent this to the newspaper, and I sent it to the radio station, posted on our website, of the upcoming board appointments. The more publicity we can get, the more we can get this out there, the more folks know that these opportunities are available. But just wanted to inform the board that there is a vacancy coming up on the Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors, the CDB Board of Directors, the DFACS Board, and then also the Department of Behavioral Health and Development Disabilities Region 1 Board. So those are some opportunities if folks want to get involved in these areas. They can certainly submit an application to our office.
Ms. Shanda, if you'll get to send us an email on the positions that are up, their terms, how long those length terms before Monday, that'd be great. And we can maybe get the word out if we don't have people that want to reapply. All right, let's review the technically next week's agenda. Ms. Shanda, I'll let you take the lead.
And it's not on the agenda, but we do have a presentation scheduled on the Hardman Trail.
Yes.
Helen Hardman Trail.
Yes. Next Monday.
Yes. Let's see, starting with item 6, that will be on the consent agenda. Item 7 will be on the consent agenda. Item 8 and item 9 will be consent. Item 10 will be voting. Item 11, consent. Item 12, voting. Item 13, voting agenda. Item 15, consent. And item 16, consent.
All right. Gentlemen, got anything else before I adjourn the work session? Okay. All right. Folks, I hereby adjourn the work session. We'll take a, what time is it?
6 o'clock.
Let's take a 5 minute break. Let's take a 5 minute break. Folks, we will convene back. Just give us a few minutes. Get our legs, stretch our legs. We're hereby adjourned. We'll go into a work call meeting in a few minutes. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry.
This series is about balancing color. To begin with, I want to cover the whole thing with the mother color wash. I'm going to use a purple as mother color here. So when I'm approaching a color balance problem, now, I think go slow, like I'm going here. It's better to go slow in the beginning. You can see that is low intensity purple. It's nearly a gray purple. That's still purple. The main thing here is to watch what happens in the color distribution. So we're distributing right now, in terms of color distribution, we're distributing violets. And I'm glad that the distribution is working out this way, because then that's going to give us an excellent opportunity to show how the distribution of or how intensity can affect the distribution. We need a little bit more of that purple in there. This lesson is about chroma. Now, we use the word chroma to mean intensity, and I usually use the term intensity when I'm talking about the role it's playing in a painting. Well, first of all, I'm starting out with a gamma dioxazine purple, and you see I've graded it in my value line using white just to create a value line. I think the thing to do, now you see this falls right in the center, which is kind of tricky to have something that is a center, something that's pulling towards the center, to fall so close to the center. So I need to pull attention away from that. I think I'm going to look at this area right in here. There are a lot of confusing images down there, and I'm not really interested in copying those images. I am interested in distributing color. And see what I'm doing here? That the yellow that was in that the background area there had become far too intense for the quality of light. that we're seeing over in this area right in here. In this lesson, we were focusing on a single thing called balancing with chroma. And what that means is our concern throughout the demonstration was the degree of color or hue that we presented with each brush stroke, or the degree of absence of hue. That's one way to say it. I didn't say it that way in the lesson, but that is one way to say it.
Thank you for your patience. Let me get started here. I hereby call this meeting, this next is a call meeting for the White County Board of Commissioners. Again, today's Monday, April 24th. I've got actually 6:11 now. I call this meeting to order. On our agenda, I'm going to be requesting a motion from the board regarding the four land use applications that we just had a public hearing on a couple hours ago. And thank you for your patience, all of you. I do appreciate it, but by the hope of doing this, you don't have to come back next week. So, all right, jumping into item two, consider the land use application of Mr. Larry Freeman to redistrict property located at 9669 Duncan Bridge Road, Cleveland, Georgia. From R1 single family to C2 highway business district, total acreage expected 1.44 acres. Tax parcel 090-047. Present use again is R1 residential. Gentlemen, what's your pleasure?
Motion to approve. Second.
Commissioner Nix first, Commissioner Hoffman second. Discussion. Having none, all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Are those opposed, say no. No lady. Moving on. Item three, consider the land use application by Ms. Sue Russell to redistrict property located at 1204 and 1206 Ridge Road, Helen, Georgia, 305-45, from C1, which is Community Commercial District, to C2, which is Highway Business District. Total acreage affected is 1.34 acres, tax parcel 042C-021. Present use again is C1 Commercial. Community Commercial District. Most of you guys, you've heard the presentation. What's your pleasure?
Motion to approve.
Mr. Hoffman first.
Second.
Commissioner Goodger second. Any discussion with the board? Having none, all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say no. Motion carries. Thank you. Excuse me. Item four, consider the land use application of Missy Lane Reynolds to redistrict. Three district property located at 1679 Helen Highway, Cleveland, Georgia, 30528, from R1 single family to C2 Highway Business District. Total acreage affected is 13.00 acres. That's tax parcel 046-008. Again, present use is R1 residential single family district. Gentlemen, what's your pleasure? All right, Commissioner Goodger, motion to approve.
Second.
Commissioner Nix, second. discussion. Ms. Elaine, I would be remiss if I didn't say this. As the future goes, whatever the future holds for everything, just understand there is a residential piece right smack, kind of in the middle there. So, all right, that's all I've got. Having said that, I got a first and second. All support of approval, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. Motion carries. Thank you. Done with that one. Moving to item five. Or you just want, since we're on, we can stop at this point and let the meal sit here for a few minutes. No, that's a joke. She's going to reach up here and jerk a knot in my tail in a minute. All right, consider land use application of Kelly and Gary Mills to redistrict Property located at 457 Highway 255 South, Cleveland, Georgia, 30528. It's currently R1 residential, going to move it to A1 agricultural forestry district. Total acreage effective is 5.0 acres. Next tax parcel is 061-089. Again, present use is R1 residential, single family. Gentlemen, what's your pleasure?
Motion to approve.
Commissioner Nix first, Commissioner Goodger second. Any discussion? Having none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, say no. Motion carries. Again, all of you, thank you for your patience. We appreciate it. You don't have to come back next week.
Thank you.
Well, you can if you want to. I'm not limiting you, but you might have other things you'd rather be doing.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, guys. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom.
All righty. Moving on to item six. All right, consider options for the 2017-18 employee benefits renewal. Gentlemen, what's your pleasure?
It's time we go over that. I see you're confused, but.
Well, we've known for about 3 years. But sooner or later, we're going to come to a head and we're going to have to do something.
Well, so to help move this along, and based upon the comments from previous meetings, Ms. Shannon, if you'll go back to that one.
Right there.
That one. Do I have a motion to go with the Alliant renewal option? I'm going to say, unfortunately, it is a 12.46% increase. Dollar amount is $193,098. Contingent upon those that are participating upon the wellness program, their premiums will be staying the same. With those who choose not to participate in the program, my understanding is, Shannon, they'll go up to $69 per pay period if they choose not to participate in the wellness program.
Well, initially at the budget presentation, we had recommended going up from $25 to $35, and then we did some further research, and we could go up as high as $69 per pay period. So that's just the board's pleasure in that.
I'm trying to help move this along.
Well,
I know what I'm hearing.
Well, I've been sitting there.
Is Alliant the only one that bid on this thing?
No.
They were just
by far the lowest.
$100,000.
And for purposes of this presentation, since they had already seen the other bids, we only left the one that the board wanted to look at on this one. But there were several other bids.
And in this motion, it would be there will be unfortunately a 12.46%. increase, $193,000, but in the presentation is the county, how to say this, would be eating the cost of the increase as long as the participant participates in our wellness program. What's your pleasure, Jim?
Satisfied, Jerry?
Yeah. I guess I would make a motion that we approve the Alliant renewal option for
based on what you said.
Yeah.
Okay. Commissioner Goodger first. Commissioner Nix second. We are now in discussion. We've been very fortunate in our, well, let's do this. Let's vote. We'll make comments after the fact. Any other comments? All right, that was Commissioner Goodger first, Commissioner Nix second. All right, closed discussion. All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, say no. Motion carries. Department heads are still here, Mr. Melton, I'd like for you to reach out to the remaining department heads and let everyone know. I think our employees need to understand, and I say that respectfully, that the county is eating this 12.49%, the 12.46% increase of $193,000. That is not being passed along to the majority of the employees. Please stress that.
The county's now at almost 1.8 million in their cost.
So over 10% of our overall budget is just for health insurance. Fair comment? Because our general fund budget's nearly 17 now. Yeah, this ain't hard.
We don't know where this is going. We know what we've done tonight, but we don't know what's in the future. We're in 12 months from now. Hopefully it will be better, but we don't know.
Ms. Shannon, do you need a motion in regard to the Blue Cross Blue Shield, or are you?
No, that's entirely employee. The county contributes a standard $84 a month on the dental insurance to help us get some better rates, because the county does contribute to that. Normally that increase is passed on to the employee because it's basically nearly 100% employee pay. But that is what they call a trend increase. Everyone across the board in the ACCG group got the same amount.
And the people that go to the doctor a lot, you know, will see that this kind of hurts a little bit, but the people that don't go to the doctor much won't notice a lot. Still a big increase for us to have to eat.
Yep.
And did that, just to clarify, that motion included the maximum for the non-wellness?
$69.
Okay.
For thank you. All right. For those who do not participate in the wellness program. All right. Sorry, I'm on the wrong page. Folks, we have an executive session. We got some matters we got to discuss in that. Gentlemen, do I have a motion to enter executive session? Mr. Hoffman first.
Second.
Mr. Goodyear second. All in favor? Pick it up, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Those opposed, say no. Sorry. We're officially executive session. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. Have a good evening. Thank you.